on. Cock feather to the top. Grip the arrow, slide back, fingertips only, under my armpit, up under my chin, onto the target, and release, straight to the gold. While I have the archery equipment out, I thought I'd make a quick video here, just to show you the basics of archery, the very bare bones of it.
At last, with Rose's help, all of the work is done, and in May, we're ready to open. Well, there we are, the foundation of the dream has been completed and now we're living the life. Where do we go from here? Well, we've decided to give it 2 or 3 years at least and see how we run financially. If we have plenty of visitors and it's worthwhile, and if we feel we can manage it, we'll remain longer. It wasn't my intention to remain here forever anyway, the maintenance is too great for me on my own. With Rosie as well, and possibly with Patrick, we shall see. If not, then we shall sell up at the end of it all, and possibly downsize, move on to something smaller near the coast, or something smaller in France, and maybe something else the other side of the world. Who knows what life will bring? It's all one big adventure, and we've taken this big risk, and we've got this far, and built the dream so far. Perhaps now, with the 5 years coming up, I should write the book. Not a year in Provence, but 5 years in Aveyron. So many tales to tell, I can tell you. So many amusing ones, and quite horrific ones as well. But all of them true. Rosie and I have both taken that huge step into adventure, into insecurity, to move on from what we had into a whole new life. Not just a holiday home or a safe English ghetto, but actually trying to be a part of the community here. So that's it from me. That gives you a brief glimpse into the life over the past 4 years and where we've got to. Now all we need is our visitors. We have a beautiful place here, so why don't you come and visit us also? I didn't build this place just for me. I'm only the caretaker here. I've recreated it, I've brought it forward, I've made it ready for the future for others to totally enjoy and use and find themselves. Not only the place itself, even after I leave, but whilst I'm here, also to share the skills and the things that I can offer people as well. Earlier on, Patrick and I had built this concrete crocodile, and as the water came up and down, with all the slime on it, it really frightened a few of the children visiting, and confused a few anglers as well. I made these wire geese, copied from Burton Agnes Hall, and of course I'd carved the wooden fish earlier. The workshop now was fully functional. Not only did I have my pottery in there, but I had a woodwork bench, lathe and everything else running. With Rose's arrival and more input, we now had all of the areas tidied up. The gallery floor had been re-varnished, the ceiling done and lighting done in the gallery, and also the kitchen areas and the workshop and studio had all been revamped. Plus, most importantly, the 4 double bedrooms had been completely redone, with each with their ensuite bathrooms and showers. Even so, I didn't realise then that my time was limited, because Rosie wasn't really happy and wanted to come back to this country, the UK. She missed her grandchildren and family and the way of life here. So we had a couple of years there, and then, as you'll see at the end of this video, we sold up and came back to England, and we'll look at the video of what happened here then later. Going upriver from the Paradou was a stang, and above a stang was a spallion, but going down the gorge we came to Ontraig, a Roman name derived from the Trier, the river Trier, and the lot, so we got Ontraig. I've always been a keen naturalist, entomologist, lepidopterist, and ornithologist, and the amount of insect life around here and the butterflies were absolutely wonderful. In France, in most places, fishermen have a right of way along the banks, and it was the same with our garden. Even though it was private, fishermen could wander along the front garden and fish their way through. Didn't really bother me anyway, as long as they didn't touch anything else. Here you see my daughter Julia using a little tractor mower to pull the dinghy up out of the water.
In summertime, the rivers became crystal clear, not only our area of the lot, and before the weed grew up too much in later summer, it was really nice to swim in there, and quite warm. I didn't use my sailing boat very much, but when I did, it was a very pleasurable experience, and even the locals that were looking and fishermen said what a pretty sight it was. We could hear them echoing up the valley. Our nearest airport was Rodez, about 30 miles away. One expects poppy fields to typify France, but in fact we didn't see that many poppy fields in our area.
earlier on I said that the next village above Astang was Espalion. It's a beautiful medieval bridge here, where in fact the very first diving bell was tested from and invented in this area. I enjoyed many hours sitting here in all sorts of weather, because this stretch was one of the best for barbel in the area. Here some of my friends are picking the TL from the lime tree. Our chickens kept us well supplied with fresh eggs, the cockerel also fertilising some so that we could use them in the incubator. Apart from very inexpensive and good wines that we found, the patisserie and also the bread were tremendous. The varieties of bread were extremely broad and varied and very, very good quality. Late summer, early autumn in Astang, they held the medieval festival. Wonderful beers, roast hams, roast pork and barbecues, cheeses, dances and music. Great entertainment. Thank you. And at this time, come autumn, they also held the Sonnet Lumiere and also the Feu d'Artifice, the firework displays. Many of the villages and towns throughout France hold these wonderful firework displays, and I must admit I am very taken by them. All sorts of wonderful little farm restaurants and other restaurants tucked away in the countryside and in the edges of towns. I was able to take my boat 7 miles or so upstream from the Paradou. It was navigable all the way, and this boat was wonderful with its parasols. I could have a bottle of wine and other drinks and foods on the way, a picnic, and my guests also used to very much enjoy this. We could fish and stop on the way if we wanted to just drift, film, or even paint, and I called this my art boat. These little fish called sunbass are not native, they're introduced. Every spring, early summer, as the water cleared, the fish would start to shoal up and breed, and they would breed especially around my rush edges and the banks of my gardens. The roach, the rudd, the tench and the carp would shoal up together, splashing and thrashing in the water, a wonderful sight to see. Unfortunately, after a couple of years, a disease hit this area and about three quarters of the stock of the 30 to 20 pound fish were killed. The very big fish survived and the smaller ones, and eventually the stocks will replace and grow again. We did phone the water board and talked about this, and they said it was a naturally occurring event throughout Aveyron. A great shame though. There was an absolutely monster fish. This female must have weighed nearly 50 pounds. I'll go into the fishing in more detail in a completely separate video and film later. I was making many new local friends, and one of them was Pierre Marie Corbel. I love his work and his partner's work as well, and they influenced mine at the time too, I mean, especially in this particular painting. Autumn was coming again, and so we were out there searching for various types of mushroom. I could take a simple bicycle ride only a few minutes up the road and absolutely fill carrier bags full of chestnuts that would last me most of winter. This was the same with walnuts, as we had several large trees around Le Paradou. They would drop off the gallery roof and accumulate at the bottom of the walls for us to pick up. And in and around Le Paradou surrounding woodlands, there's some absolutely magical areas, almost like rainforests. You see here the sphagnum moss hanging down these lovely old box trees, little mountain streams coming down through the woodlands, hanging glades and so on, wild fruits and all sorts of lovely trees and flowers hiding amongst and nestling amongst all of this wilderness.
Another year soon passes by, autumn arrives, and the first deep hoarfrost. Although comparatively, winter doesn't actually start to set in until nearly November, December, because it's a much longer summer, but when they do up in the mountains, it becomes...
Thank you.
My bird table and feeders are used all the way through, but especially in winter, where such a shortage of food occurs up in these mountainous regions. I'm sure there are many, many birds that I've saved by having that food out there, and it's such a delight to me. I see so much from this window looking out down the lawns, down to the river. Waterfowl, wildfowl, small birds, large birds, birds of prey, all sorts. And some very unusual ones too. In a moment I'll show you a hoopoe. The coypies had vanished for a while, and I thought they'd completely gone, but here's an old animal just taking his leisurely swim across the lot in front of my house.